Breaking news. President Trump saying tonight he has five names on his list to replace outgoing UN Ambassador Nikki Haley. One name not on the list, his daughter, Ivanka. The first daughter tweeting tonight the following: "That replacement will not be me." Now that we have that confirmed, this came, though, soon after her father talked about her as glowingly as one could, saying that she would make a, quote, dynamite ambassador. So with Ivanka Trump off the list, who is on the shortlist? One name that I'm told is Dina Powell. She's a former deputy national security advisor who left the administration last year. She left the administration last year. It is something that the president, though, also confirmed earlier tonight.
Dina is certainly a person I would consider, and she is under consideration.
Jeff Zeleny is in Council Bluffs, Iowa right now, where President Trump is about to take the stage for a rally. Jeff, what else do we know about who might replace Nikki Haley and when it might happen?
Well, Kate, the president said earlier today he plans to make this decision in the next 2 to 3 weeks. So it's unclear if it'll be done before the midterm elections. There's no real hurry in this because, of course, she said she will stay until the end of the year. And this isn't exactly central on his mind. He's going to be doing a lot of rallies, stops like this, over the next month. We are 1 month till the midterms. But there's no question there will be a lot of people vying for the position. And as of now, I mean, with Ivanka Trump sort of saying she's not interested. And one of the reasons is, the reality is the financial disclosure she would have to go through for a confirmation hearing would be something that she may not be willing to do. So, of course, Dina Powell's name is first and foremost, but also look at some senators who are leaving the Senate, perhaps. Senator Bob Corker from Tennessee, chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee. He's had a rocky relationship with President Trump, but he's a possible name that was mentioned. There will be a lot of people who are mentioned for this position. The question is, though, which direction will the president go? His cabinet is not exactly brimming over with women and minorities. So that is something that he's been interested in and concerned about. So we'll see if that is a factor for him, Kate.
Yeah, and despite what the president said earlier today, Nikki Haley's resignation did come as a surprise to many in the administration. Right, Jeff?
No question. People inside the White House were not expecting the president to make that announcement today. But I'm told that he wanted to make the Oval Office announcement to make it look like someone was not leaving him in anger, that he was in charge of the departure. We've seen so many people essentially, resigning by tweet or leaving by tweet. This was definitely a soft landing and an official Oval Office departure. But it was a surprise to John Bolton, the National Security Advisor, to the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo. It was very closely held. But Kate, the key thing, the date on the resignation letter was October 3rd. That is a week ago tomorrow. That is when Nikki Haley met with President Trump in the Oval Office to give him that resignation letter. That happened to come, though, the morning after the president mocked Christine Blasey Ford at a rally just like this in Mississippi. So he did not want to publicly accept the resignation then in the middle of the Kavanaugh fight. It was saved until today. But Kate, it's one of the rare examples we've seen. The president kept this very close to the vest and virtually no one else knew about it. Kate?
Good point. Maybe the one and only that we at least have on the record right now. Great to see you, Jeff. Thank you very much. Up front with me tonight, Doug High. He's a former communications director for the RNC. Paul Begala, former White House counselor to President Clinton. And Julie Hirschfeld Davis, White House reporter for the New York Times. It's great to see you guys. It's great to have you here, Julie. What do you make of the announcement? Quite a strange day.
It was, and it is, as Jeff just pointed out, it's fairly unusual to see somebody get the kind of Oval Office treatment on their way out the door.
Yeah.
He kind of went out of his way. And we know that, you know, Nikki Haley has felt pretty free to disagree with President Trump. She wrote that op-ed in the Washington Post after the anonymous op-ed ran in the New York Times, basically saying, I've had my differences with the president, but I'm never afraid to voice them. And so, you know, that's sort of been her sort of persona that she's forged within this administration. And for him to affirmatively want to do that photo op with her and talk at length about what she's meant to this administration was, I think, pretty significant. Mm-hmm. And I think there were interests, her interests and his interests was in showing sort of an amicable parting. But I think we're going to find out in the months ahead what was behind this decision, why she timed it the way she did. I think Jeff is right. She didn't want to leave, and he didn't want her to leave in the middle of the Kavanaugh fight. But there's also the midterm election coming up.
Right.
And if Republicans lose the House or the Senate, which is a possibility, I think she did not want it to look like she was jumping ship at a difficult time.
Fascinating. I mean, the timing here, Timing here is an important thing. It is a fascinating thing, Paul. I mean, the president today said that he at least said that he knew it was coming. Listen to this.
She told me probably 6 months ago, she said, you know, maybe at the end of the year, at the end of a 2-year period, but the end of the year, I want to take a little time off. I want to take a little break.
But just to reiterate, as Jeff was pointing out, sources tell CNN, John Bolton and Mike Pompeo were surprised by the announcement. In fact, it seems like almost all senior administration officials, and there are a lot of them, were caught off guard by this. If it wasn't coordinated, if this was sudden, why? What does it mean?
The truth is, I have no idea. I have no idea why they can't get even this is a very important job, but this is a simple personnel matter. Right. It 2 years is a reasonable tenure for a U.N. ambassador, by the way. This will probably ruin her chances when she runs for president. She did a very good job. She's one of the stars of this star-crossed administration. And yet they can't seem to even get the blocking and tackling right. I have no idea why. I will say this. Nikki Haley, as U.N. ambassador, she has been able to maneuver properly from allies and adversaries and all the backstabbing. And that's just at the Trump White House. She's had to do the same thing at the UN. So it's taken an enormous amount of diplomatic talent to get to where she is. I just don't know why she is leaving so abruptly. It doesn't make sense.
Yeah, diplomacy, not your strong suit, I'll tell you that, Paul.
I'm praising her, though. I'm praising a Republican. give me a little credit.
You started by saying manipulating and then maneuvering, okay?
No, that was literally, I just misspoke.
I'm kidding. Yeah, I just like to do that with you, except I'm not. Haley did not shed much light today, Doug, on why she's leaving. I mean, she said, She made clear, she said it's not for personal reasons. She also said she believes in term limits, which may come back to bite her later. But she made very clear one thing, that she is not leaving because she has any presidential aspirations, at least in 2020. Listen to this.
I will say this for all of you that are going to ask about 2020. No, I'm not running for 2020. I can promise you what I'll be doing is campaigning for this one.
But is this about 2024? Or more immediately, as Julie was saying, is this about the potential of the president's party getting shellacked in the midterm?
Well, obviously, some of us, and myself included, expect that the party will, at least on the House side, get shellacked in the midterms. But no one's going to blame the UN ambassador for anything that happens politically in any given congressional district, especially given that Nikki Haley has been such a star for this administration and with so many White House and administration and employees basically having a lifespan shorter than milk, that Nikki Haley's not been only able to survive this long, but been really able to thrive, build relationships, build credibility, and be a steady hand at very unsteady times, has made her a real, not just a rock star, but a real rock for this administration. It's not going to have any real impact on the elections, but certainly anything that happens in this White House, we know, is going to be more choppy water that they have to deal with.
Well, and of course, now, and talk about the next, I don't know, choppy water for this position, that who's going to replace Nikki Haley? I mean, she went out of her way, and I know, like, forensically dissecting this, what they said in the Oval Office, but everything was fascinating. She went out of her way to effusively praise the president, his family, especially Jared and Ivanka. Julie, watch this.
I can't say enough good things about Jared and Ivanka. Jared is such a hidden genius that no one understands. We're a better country because they're in this administration.
So Ivanka took herself out of the running tonight. Dina Powell, former deputy national security advisor, she is top of the list, on the short list, if you will, because the president said that tonight. What are you hearing? Who could it be?
Well, I mean, I think Dina Powell has a very good chance of getting this position, not only because, you know, the president has mentioned her. He then said on Air Force One to a bunch of reporters that she would love it, that she, you know, she's up for this, you know, and just as Nikki Haley went out of her way to show that she was very close with Jared and Ivanka and there was no daylight between them,
right,
they're also very close with Dina Powell. They are all of a piece. There is a dwindling number of people.
Could she get confirmed easily? I feel like,
well,
yes-ish.
I think that she could be confirmed more easily than some of the people that Trump might choose for this post. Don't forget, she already was confirmed for a presidentially nominated position in the Bush administration, so she's been through that process.
True.
She's done that. And frankly, a lot of Democrats who deal with foreign policy on Capitol Hill, for them, she's a known quantity. They, I think, trust her more than they might trust some other people who the president might consider, certainly more than Rick Grenell, who's the ambassador to Germany right now. You know, he's been quite partisan in his or he had been before he was in his current position. So I think that they would consider her to be a little bit more of a familiar face, and she might have an easier time. But that said, it's going to be a fight. You know, this will end up being sort of a proxy battle over President Trump's foreign policy and his disdain for multilateral organizations like the UN, and she will have to deal with that just as any nominee would have to deal with
that.
I think
that's an excellent point.
If she ends up being the person.